All right. Welcome back to Chemistry 150. We were talking about alcohols. This is chapter 12 in the Denniston book. And today I want to conclude chapter 12 with talking about thiols. But before we talk about thiols, I just kind of want to, a lot of people like wonder why thiols are talked about in a chapter on alcohols. Well, remember when we started this chapter, that we started with water and oxygen being more electronegative than hydrogen. We have unequal sharing of the electrons between the hydrogen and the oxygen, and that creates polar covalent bonds. And the next group of compounds that we talked about were alcohols, where we substitute one of the hydrogens for an alkyl group. So we get this type of compound. And again, oxygen being more electronegative than hydrogen, we get a polar covalent bond between the oxygen and hydrogen again. So we have water, and we have alcohol. And as long as the alkyl group is not very large, the alcohol will dissolve in water. So like when we mix ethanol and water together, the ethanol completely dissolves in the water. Why does that happen? Well, that's because they're both have a polar part. Water itself is a polar molecule. It means it has a positive and negative end to it. We can do that two ways. We can show a force, the electrons being pulled towards the oxygen, so the overall resultant force is in an upward direction. Or you can do an imaginary line through the molecule, and it's strictly negative on this side of the molecule and strictly positive on the bottom side down here. So it's a polar molecule. It has a positive and negative end to it. Well, the same thing with the alcohol. This part, the R is generally nonpolar, so if we just focus on this part here, we would see there's a positive and negative end to this part of the molecule. Negative on this side, positive on this side. So that, as long as the R is not too large, this hydroxyl group dominates and the alcohol will dissolve in water. Another thing that is happening here is that, remember that with water, when hydrogen is bonded to oxygen, nitrogen, or fluorine, and that creates this partial negative on the oxygen, partial positive on the hydrogens, we get hydrogen bonding, where if, let's say, we have an alcohol in close proximity to the water, the partial negative on this oxygen creates a force of attraction. It's not a true bond, but it's a force of attraction. It's stronger than a dipole-dipole moment where we just have a positive-negative attracted to another positive-negative. This particular force of attraction called hydrogen bonding, and that's going to be really important in biological systems. This is what, again, makes alcohols and water have higher melting points and boiling points. This is also what plays in where water, if we have other water molecules around, it creates these voids when the water freezes, and that's why water is less dense as a solid than a liquid, which is generally not the case. Most things, the solid is more dense than the liquid. So that's why we've talked about water and alcohol in chapter 12. Then we went to another group of compounds that look like this. And to go from an alcohol to an ether, we were oxidizing. And you go, why is it oxidation? Well, you've lost a hydrogen. And remember, oxidation is either the addition of oxygen to a compound or the loss of hydrogen. So this group of compounds were called ethers. And ethers do not have the hydrogen bonding that occurs with alcohols and water. So ethers have lower melting points and boiling points. A lot of sometimes ethers readily evaporate or could be gases at room temperature. So the last group of compounds is that we're going to take, again, instead of oxygen, we're going to take sulfur to be our central atom. And attached to that's going to be an alkyl group R, and attached to the other side is going to be a hydrogen. So again, it looks similar to water, except we've replaced the oxygen with sulfur, which is in the same group, and we would expect similar chemical properties between the oxygen and sulfur here. But overall, the properties of the molecule are going to be different because, first of all, we don't have hydrogen bonding. Again, hydrogen bonding only occurs with when hydrogen is bonded to oxygen, nitrogen, or fluorine. So here we have hydrogen bonded to sulfur. So this group of compounds are going to be called thiols. Thiols. All right. So why are thiols so important? Well, generally thiols, we think of skunk, what you smell coming from a skunk, or garlic or onions. They tend to have some antibacterial properties. That's why, like maybe Bactrim, if you're taking sulfa drugs. So we're looking at those type of compounds, and the most important part I think about the thiols, and they talk about this in the book, and we probably ought to stress it a little bit more, is that if I take a thiol and I react it with another thiol, and I do an oxidation reaction. Remember, oxidation means removal of hydrogen or the addition of oxygen. In this case, we're going to remove the hydrogens. We get a sulfur-sulfur bond, like so. The sulfur-sulfur bond is really important in biological systems. We'll see it more later. We're going to see it in DNA. We're going to see it in certain molecules like the one mentioned in the book about insulin. And what this does is these sulfur-sulfur bonds cause these enzymes to, if we link all these amino acids or proteins, we can get a structure, maybe it looks like that for an enzyme. So another structure could come in that locks into this, that has the, so this is the shape of the enzyme, and then this other structure locks right into it, and so we have another reaction. But it's based on the actual shape and structure of the entire molecule. And if this little piece here was not present, this wouldn't lock in right. Or if this other piece up here had another bump on it, it wouldn't lock into this, what we'll call part A down here. So sulfur-sulfur bonds are very important in creating the three-dimensional structure of proteins or enzymes, and they can be very selective in what they will react with. And that's what we're going to see, the importance of these sulfur-sulfur bonds. So how do you name a thiol? Well, it's much like when we're looking at the ethers. So we have, we look for the longest chain of the of carbon, and so this would be ethane. So we would say ethane thiol. All right. We could also make this where we knock off another hydrogen off the carbon, and we get something like this. And just like alcohols, we can have diols for alcohols. We can have dithiols for this compound, for the thiol. So this one would be ethane dithiol. All right. So we name these pretty much like you name an alcohol. Instead of OH here and here, we have thiol. So this is a dithiol. All right. So for this compound, we have to tell the people that it's on the first and second carbon. First and second carbon. So this is 1,2-ethane dithiol. Because you could have both of the thiol groups on one carbon. So you could have 1,1-ethane dithiol. So you got to be careful there. Make sure that you tell the person if you have more than one thiol where it's located. Let's do one more. Let's start off with the chain. Let's say something like let's put this here. All right, so let's say we're looking at this compound. All right, so we look for our longest chain, carbon 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Either way we go, we have 6. It doesn't matter if we went like this and down or if we went straight across. It's 6 carbons long. So knowing that it's 6 carbons long, we know that's hexane. And knowing that it has this SH group on it, that's a thiol. All right. So which one takes precedence, the methyl group or the thiol group? Well, the thiol group does. So it should have the lowest number. So we would call this... this has to be carbon number 3, because if we went the other way, it would be carbon number 4. So if this is carbon 3, this one's 4, this one's 5, we would say 5-methyl3-hexanethiol. 5-methyl-3-hexanethiol. All right? So keep in mind the thiol group has precedence over the alkyl groups. All right, that's where we'll stop. This will finish chapter 12. The next chapter that we'll cover is on aldehydes and ketones. Thank you.